चलो मेरी वाली प्रेजेंटेशन लगाओ। मैं आपको नजर आ रहा हूं, स्लाइड्स आ गई मेरी नजर?
हाँ जी सर।
अच्छा चलो ठीक है जी।
तो सर ये पीपीटी के साथ में ये साथ में विंडोज ये ऐसे ही रहेंगी राइट साइड पे?
हाँ एक तरफ आप लोग तो फ्रेम में रहेंगे।
ओके
हाँ जी
ओके,
हाँ जी,
इसको हम मिनिमाइज कर सकते हैं? नहीं
मिनिम कर दिया हमने, मिनिमम इसको देख ले मनवीत, और मिनिमाइज अभी ऑन तो नहीं कर रहे ये कह रहे हैं इसको मिनिमाइज करने के
क्योंकि जो पीपीटी का टेक्स्ट है वो मिस ना हो जाए बीच में ना,
लिए।
जैसे ड्यू
कर रहे हैं
टू
भैया, जस्ट ट्राइंग इट।
विंडो। ओके
ये तो स्पीकर फ्रेम में चाहिए ना, इनको फिर इसको थोड़ा सा और कर ले। डॉक्टर वीपी सिंह, थोड़ा सा कई बार हो जाता है थोड़ा सा,
ओके सर,
हाँ
नो
इतना तो हो
प्रॉब्लम।
जाएगा अभी। तो वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद द लाइव स्ट्रीमिंग। ओके
राइट सर,
ओके जी।
राइट।
सो गुड आफ्टरनून, नमस्कार, सत श्री अकाल। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ इंदिरा गांधी मेडिकल कॉलेज शिमला एंड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ मेडिकल एजुकेशन, वी वेलकम यू आवर कंटिन्यूइंग सीरीज ऑफ वेबकास्ट ड्यूरिंग कोविड पेंडेमिक। एंड टुडे सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस इश्यूज ऑन द मेडिको लीगल इश्यूज इंक्लूडिंग टेलीमेडिसिन। एंड फॉर दिस वी हैव अ स्टार स्टडीड फैकल्टी फ्रॉम अवर डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्री। वी हैव अ डॉक्टर सतीश तिवारी हु डजंट नीड इंट्रोडक्शन because he is known to us and one the legendary figure in medico legal. And along with we are having Dr. Satish Sharma from Rohtak, who is the secretary of this chapter. And we have one more esteemed colleague, Dr. VP Singh. He is going to discuss about certain very important issues which we are not going, which we miss most of the time. And lastly, I am going to take around 15-20 minutes to discuss. So I welcome you all and wish you all the best of this session. And we know that we are in part of this COVID-19, and it has given us a number of lessons what we can. And one is telemedicine and telehealth, and which is going to take us to so many things. So probably, and advantage of technology, and we all know that this landscape is changing daily. We can see, we are not able to see the other end. So there's uncharted territory as we were talking about medical legal cases as well as telemedicine. So though some things have changed, but few things have not changed, like our duty of care remains the same because we have to look after sick people, whether they are suffering from any disease. And as per our oath, we have obligation to society, institution and ourselves. And the standard of care is there because then we have some SOPs and which we are supposed to practice in all circumstances. So what is changing? This is actually a very important issue. If people were looking into the yesterday data, there are around 400 plus healthcare personnel from AIIMS who have contracted this disease. Workload has increased manifold because a particular disease, we are seeing number of news reports, both volume and type. Type, we are just engaged with one type of the patients. And at certain places, the resources stands exhausted. They are going to add on. Even today, ministry is going to add on. They are going to have some makeshift. And we have lot of information, so we want to concise that information. At the same time, we want the life and care of our colleagues very safe also. So we have a defined few learning objectives, and my esteemed learned faculty will deliberate on them. So we are going to discuss to begin with some common medical legal issues because this pandemic we are not aware most of the time. And as per the oath we were discussing earlier, we have some obligation to the public, and we are going to identify what are the going to the best support strategy for practice and patient care. And finally, we have how to handle sudden death and if something happens, along with a good record keeping, because we all know record keeping is very important. And finally, something about telemedicine briefly. So with this, we welcome you all, and we have this link on, and we have, if you have any queries, my learned faculty will be more than happy to answer. So you can just jot down in the chat box. And with this, I'll request our first speaker of the day, Dr. Satish Tiwari. And Dr. Satish Tiwari is going to discuss medico-legal case scenarios. So with this, I welcome you, Dr. Satish, again. And over to you. Over to you.
Yes. So thank you, organizers, for giving this opportunity.
Rather, we are thankful to you for taking out all of your time, just on very short notice and one phone call.
Yes. Yeah. And as per your suggestion, we'll be discussing some landmark judgments or cases. And these cases are not which are the case scenarios which are tentative or which are hypothetical. These are actual cases decided by the various courts in our country. So I will be discussing the cases and the principle behind that, or the aim, or what we can say, the basic thing behind that cases. So before we proceed for the actual cases, it is said that doctors' treatment work in patients who are destined to live. And if someone of us is not convinced, you can see these two photographs. The first one is either dollars or euros or rupees which are lying down on the road. And probably in this COVID era, people in Western countries or European countries, they are unable to save the life in spite of so many money or so many of resources with them. And the second photograph is a photograph of a line which the person who has sent it, according to him, our time of death is fixed. Whatever resources you have, whatever things you have, but once your call has come, nobody can stop you. And this is probably what is happening in the Western countries and in most of the European countries. And all of you must be viewing Ramayana in the present COVID pandemic. And according to Ramayana, Anilab Jeevan Maran just Vidhi Hat. That means loss and gain, life and death, fame and defame is in the hands of luck or destiny. So with these two background slides, we'll start with some of the important judgments which as a medical practitioners we should know. Now the first question, all patients can be future litigant. How many of you agree we have to decide? And based on this, whether all the patients are future litigants or not, I'm going to discuss some actual case laws decided by various courts. The first case which I would discuss is IMA versus VP Santa. This is a Supreme Court judgment as early as 1996, so almost 25 years now, where all the doctors were brought under the Consumer Protection Act. And the Supreme Court was of the view that interest of consumer is more important than the interest of doctors, because doctors are in a better position to fight the cases as compared to the patient or the consumer who is might be poor many times. So the Consumer Protection Act is patient-friendly act. Not only this decision, in 2008 again, Supreme Court says that the Consumer Protection Act is patient-friendly. Then there is another very important judgment in 1996 only, where according to Supreme Court, if you want to do medical practice, you require a qualification. Not only a qualification, there has to be permissible registration by a proper or a competent authority. So you have to get registered for practicing. This only gives you right to practice. So unless and until you have a qualification and a proper registration, you cannot practice. And the different systems, by mutual exclusion of another system, they have ruled out you can not practice the other pathy. Like if you are modern medicine or allopathy doctor, you cannot practice homeopathy. If you are a Ayurvedic practitioner or Ayurvedic graduate, then you cannot practice homeopathy. So if you practice outside the your pathy, which you have been taught during your UG and PG curriculum, then basically you are a quack and not a quack. The Spring Meadows Hospital versus Harjot Ahluwalia is again 1998 decision, Supreme Court decision again, which says minor child as well as parents are the consumer. And it has also discussed the concept of vicarious liability. We will subsequently discuss what is vicarious liability. So Supreme Court in 1998 said what is vicarious liability. Then this is a very important judgment where in Jacob Matthews versus State of Punjab, the things like what is civil negligence and criminal negligence was discussed. And at the same time, court says there is need to protect doctors from unjust pressure or false complaint. Please remember, though the Consumer Protection Act is patient friendly, most of the judiciary or the court are in favor of the medical practitioner. So for any Tom, Dick and Harry, they may not give decision against the Sarda Kohli versus Dr. Manchanda. I think it is related to one of the very important Supreme Court judgment related to the consent. Dr. Satish Sharma will discuss it in detail. As far as the consent is concerned, again, Dr. Sharma will take, but please remember, we are in the era where informed consent is important. So we will not go again into details of this slide. But just look at the last two yellow colored lines. The cost and expenses put in, as well as if you are charging something extra for PPE or mask or because of some COVID reason, that should be explained in the consent. And we have a lot of queries whether you take special consent for the corona. So I think there is no need for special consent for corona to each and every patient who is coming in the OPD. What you can have, you can just have a board or a pamphlet kept in the OPD that these are the specific guidelines or these are the universal precautions which you must take while coming in the hospital or while going from the hospital. So you have to just display all the universal guidelines and those are followed in the hospital. So each and every OPD patient, you may not need special consent due to corona pandemic. A very important judgment of National Commission 2008, where it says that consent should have, or in this case, it was the last two lines, consent also included that I am willing for a postmortem in the unfortunate event of death. So according to the courts, you should give a proper information and even the what can be the complication. So in this case, National Commission, they have complimented the doctor that they have taken a consent that even death can occur on the table. The H.S. Sharma versus Apollo Hospital 2007 judgment, where it says that it is incumbent upon doctors to maintain the records according to MCI Act. And we'll not go again into detail. The last line, which is important in this judgment, is the discharge summary shall not be mechanical, but patient friendly. So you have to have discharge card, which is patient friendly. This is another judgment. You just look at the blue colored line. Death occurred in OT. And what happened in OT, patient or relatives cannot know. So normally the burden of proof of negligence is on the patient or the relatives, but where they don't have access, the burden shifts over to the doctors. If something happens in the OT or in the ICU where patient does not have access, the doctors, we have to prove that how we were not negligent. So this is very important, one of the principle of the judiciary. Again, this judgment 2005, the court says suspicion, however strong is, it cannot be a ground to presume negligence. So again, the patient only on suspicion cannot prove that doctor were negligent. He has to produce the expert evidence. So that is important for deciding the cases. In this National Commission judgment, the commission has said that missing the diagnosis of malignancy is not negligence, it is error of judgment. And this judgment again, the court says it is an unfortunate outcome and it is not a case of res ipsa loquitur. We will discuss what is principle of res ipsa loquitur. So it can be unfortunate outcome or error of judgment. So every case is not negligence. In this case, the court has said that there was a delayed referral. So please remember, we have to refer the case. If it is not possible for us to manage the case should be referred at proper time. This is one of the very important judgments for all the pediatricians and the neonatologists. Here, a 3.1 kg baby delivered by cesarean section developed jaundice on the fourth day. Baby was shifted without mother. The powder milk was given with bottle, so not with katori spoon, but with bottle. Baby omitted. There was aspiration, septicemia, multi organ failure, and died. So please remember, it is very difficult to protect or to defend a case if there is a bottle feeding. So all of us should take care. There should not be bottle feeding. And the use of powder milk should be very judicious. So you just cannot go on using powder milk without a proper indication. And one of the important violation you can see for the powder milk or formula milk is this photograph on this slide, which is last month's photograph. So during pandemic, this is the government authorities like police or military or CRPF. They are distributing powder milk. So this is the violation, gross violation of the IMS Act, which all pediatricians and neonatologists must know. There cannot be such distribution of the formula milk or the powder milk. You can give any other food material if you want to distribute, but not the powder milk. Now, as we said about, discussed about the expert opinion should be produced by the patient or the relatives. In this case, 2008 judgment of National Commission, you can see the case was our orthopedic department, but the affidavit or the support was filed and the expert opinion was filed by BBS. So this was not accepted by the court. The court says if it is expert evidence, it should be by the expert. So nobody other can file the expert evidence. Now, as far as the consumer courts are concerned, there is a limitation period when the case can be admitted or when the patient or relatives can go to the court. But if you see the last but one line in this case, the consumer court have every power to delay the condone. So there can be delay can be condoned, but at the same time, if the court feel no, the delay was not proper. So here the case was declared time barred. So according to the Consumer Protection Act, you have to go within 2 to 3 years from the date of the incidence. So you cannot go after that unless and until court gives you special or court condones the delay. This is very important judgment. All of must have a copy of this judgment. Another Supreme Court judgment 2009. Where Supreme Court says no sensible professional will have mens rea. Mens rea means guilty mind. That means no doctor wants that patient should die in his hospital. And many times the cases are as a pressurizing tool for the doctors. So they have to keep in mind, and before admitting any case, they should take the opinion of the expert. At the same time, Supreme Court warned the police officer not to harass or arrest the doctor. If there is any problem, you have to have a copy of this judgment. We will discuss one or two more cases as I feel I am running out of the time. So this is another Supreme Court judgment, that 11 crore judgment, where there was a cleavage of opinion. So you have to keep in mind that if there are different school of thought, you can select any one mode of treatment. That is known as cleavage of opinion. And in this case, again, Supreme Court says that the situation of cases against doctor may not be proper in India. Doctors may refuse to treat, and younger generation may avoid medical courses. So we have to keep in mind this important case. Then this is ROP case. I think this is at present one of the highest sanctioning of compensation after that 11 crore, 1.8 crore. And we have to keep in mind, especially all pediatricians, obstetrician, and the neonatologist, the ROP should be properly advised in each and every patient where it can be a possibility.
So,
just two or three minutes, last two or three slides. Res ipsa loquitur is the things where the things are very obvious and there is no need to prove anything, and the things are very obvious. Then we will not discuss this. Lastly, we should be a CME doctor, continuing medical education doctor, and not a company medical representative educated doctor. And please avoid cross-pathy and cross-speciality. Lastly, I will request all of you to join this association. It's working only for medical, legal, and ethical issues. And the various benefits award our member. So I hope after today's discussion, our members will start thinking out of the box. Thank you again. Thank you all organizers for giving this opportunity. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Tiwari, for this brief and exhaustive presentation. With this, we move on to the second part of our today's presentation, that has to be discussed by Dr. Sthish Sharma, and he is going to elaborate on record keeping, consent and documentation, because that has become more important as we are going more and more through this pandemic. So over to Dr. Sthish. Dr. Tiwari had to be there because we are going to take the question in the end, so that there are a few questions which are to be answered only by you.
I am there throughout the program.
Also. Yeah, yeah. डॉक्टर सतीश, आपकी स्लाइड्स नहीं आई अभी, प्लीज
स्लाइड्स
या स्लाइड्स आर नॉट विजिबल, यू आर विजिबल ऑन या आपने वो शेयर कर दिए हैं?
मैं शेयर, एक मिनट सर, देखता हूँ.
इसको आप उस पे व्यू पे कर लीजिए, फुल व्यू पे. प्लीज गो अहेड.
एट द वेरी ऑनसेट आई कन्वे माय थैंक्स टू ऑर्गेनाइजर एंड प्रोफेसर सूद फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस वेबिनार ऑन द मेडिकल लीगल इश्यूज. एंड दिस प्रॉपर कंसेंट डॉक्यूमेंटेशन रिकॉर्ड कीपिंग इज नॉट द न्यू थिंग. It was a 100-year, 200-year back, Atharved has been mentioned. And in this note on this era of COVID, but otherwise, we should document our communication
whatever we communicate to the patient, we should document it. And whatever we documentation, we should communicate to the patient. This is very, very important. And what is the definition of consent? Consent is defined as an agreement, compliance, or permission given voluntarily without any compulsion. And it is a continuous permission of the patient to receive a particular treatment based on his adequate knowledge, what is being done, what the purpose of this treatment, what is the nature of the treatment, and what are its likely effect, and what are the risks involved in this treatment or in operation, and what is the success rate, and what are the alternative form in treatment. So person who give consent properly, he cannot go to court or complaint later on, because this has been discussed with him after a lot of reasoning and deliberation, after explaining to him. And he knows what is the effects of this, what are the good effects, what are the bad effects. The consent can be a implied consent. Implied consent means the person, by virtue of his gesture or position, he gives the consent. For example, a patient is coming for immunization to a doctor. It is the implied consent that injection will be given. When somebody going to laboratory for blood testing, so patient is rolling his, he want to give sample, and he is implied that the sample will be taken. When a female goes to a gynecologist, so for it is implied that gynecologist do an internal examination. So these are the some implied consent. Blanket means this is a general consent. When a patient is admitted in the hospital, a consent is taken, and maybe for any treatment, for surgery, for investigation, and this is not specific consent, and this is not valid in the court of law. Similarly, proxy in some, if the patient doesn't give the consent, maybe the other relative, his in-laws, his husband, or other patient they give, this is a proxy consent. The third party consent, again, is somebody else, third person give consent on behalf of the patient, it also doesn't have a legal validity. Whatever in routine course of time, our staff member, staff nurse, or return, they take the consent on just a piece of paper or whatever is written. So infant consent should be a proper and should be informed consent. Exceeding consent. If during the course of treatment or in something happened, you have taken a consent for a particular procedure or a surgery, and if you want to extend that surgery or something happened during the surgery, and then you have to take the exceeding consent. Now there are exception when the consent is not able, cannot be taken when this is a medical emergency, or the court can order, or there are some day cases if the police bring somebody for the examination, for psychiatric examination. So this is in the public interest in the, by the court of law. And these, for example, somebody in the army, in case of a person suffering from a notifiable disease, some immigrant or member of armed forces. So in case of a, in these cases, the consent can be avoided. Now, proper is the, we discuss about the informed consent. This is very, very important. And this is will save you in the court of law. And the consent should be taken in comprehensible. We should not discuss in medical term, in simple language, preferably in patient own language. And there are six components of this part. These are very, very important. What is the diagnosis should be explained to the patient? Whether this is nature of the treatment, whether we are going to give some chemotherapy, we are want to some operation, or we want to give radiotherapy, or this only IV fluid, antibiotic, like that. And what are the risks involved in the treatment? What are the chances of the success? Whether 70% cure, or you may have landed with this procedure. For example, patient is given being chemotherapy. We should discuss, there will be follow up here. So patient, we have to discuss about this patient. And what will happen if the patient doesn't give consent to the doctor for the procedure? So you have to tell him that. And again, you have to explain what will be alternative method of this treatment. If you are not going for the surgery, you are going for a medical treatment. So what are the future perspective? What are the percentage of the cure? So these six components has to be explained in detail to the patient. And if you take all these components properly, then you are saved in the court of law. I will discuss about some true court cases. This is a case of a leukemia, but the patient treatment was given a typhoid, patient expired, and the patient went to court, okay, my diagnosis was leukemia, and doctor was treating me wrongly. But in this case, the doctor bone marrow advised repeatedly, but patient did not give consent for bone marrow. And this was a contributory negligence on the part of the patient. What the court observed, that complainant has not been able to show us a proof that the doctor should have done and which he did not do. So this case was dismissed, or this was because it was a contributory negligence and patient did not give the consent. In case of investigation, for the diagnosis of clinical diagnosis, you want to confirm such diagnosis after history examination, simple test. So advise only the necessary investigation. Don't advise unnecessary investigation. If patient doesn't go for your advice, doesn't go for investigation, then again this is a contributory negligence. So timely diagnosis, timely treatment, and timely to anticipate what can be the complication for the or risk involved in the treatment. So you have to seek diagnosis, treatment, proper referral at the proper time is very, very important. And you can anticipate whether the patient will have fulminant course or the complication will be too remote, then it is not a negligence. Now this is the case of Dr. Lahiri versus Dr. Pawan Kumar. Dr. Lahiri was himself a doctor. He was a case of chronic COPD and he was suffering from ischemic heart disease. He has a heart disease, heart problem, and angiography was done. And it was a three-vessel block was diagnosed. And he was a doctor himself. He knew everything. He knew the risk. But after the operation, the patient died. He could not save. And there's some, but he said that this was a fault of the surgeon. But here the risk was explained. And the doctor was himself a doctor. And he was competent to make the choice of the hospital and the doctor. So there is difference between failure due to health condition or due to negligence. So no deficiency in rendering adequate care was found in this case, and there was no case against the doctor was proved. Again, the DN, this case of medical college versus Subramaniam, this is 2008 case. In here, the child was admitted with a respiratory distress, and the doctor in the hospital, the consultant, they advised that this is a case. And you should do intercostal drainage, pneumothorax. Somehow, either the resident or the consultant, the tube was not available, whatever was the reason, this was not carried out, and the patient died. Although the cause of death may not be, he would have, if he even have put drainage, but the patient took it. That the treatment advised and the doctor did not carry out. So fact remains that treatment prescribed was not carried out. So compensation was awarded by district forum, and this was upheld by the Tamil Nadu State Commission. Regarding the referral, we should refer the patient at the timely and in severe cases after completing the life-saving procedure. And for better specific assistance, these are the petition by the 1988, that doctor should not care beyond one qualification, the skill and the experience. As Dr. Tiwadiya sir has said, you should not cross your limits and your competency. You do give some first aid treatment or you stabilize the patient and then you refer. And you have to write in detail about the chronological events. The patient came with the blood pressure, his blood pressure was falling and there was this, and we give this treatment, now this stabilize, and we are referring for better care. Now again, this is a case. A case of acute severe dehydration because of severe gastroenteritis. This was admitted in pediatrician and he just was given oral fluid. Patient become more severe. The doctor left for, this was a case of Rajasthan. He left for some other place in Jodhpur and he did not give any instruction. He did not relegate the duty to his colleague that I'm leaving and you take out in my, to take care of the pain in my absence. The patient expired. You can see the wording of the code. They say, although this is a noble profession, but this is a profit industry. What are the lines? There is greed for money for the doctor, and this was proved to be culpable negligence, and doctor was awarded 3 lakhs. So valid consent, friends. You should be very specific about the consent, very particular about the consent. And the consent should be in writing, not verbal consent, and you should not misrepresent the facts. You should not hide the fact. Full explanation, full understand. And this should be signed by the 2 witnesses, either 2 patients or 2 hospital staff, it should be, or some 2 neutral patients. This is Samira Kohli. This was a lady who was having dysmenorrhea or menorrhagia. He was planned for a surgery for his hysterectomy. And the gynecologist on operation found that this is severe endometriosis. And after hysterectomy, in addition, he removed the ovary, fallopian tube. Then the patient later on went to court that without my consent, they have removed my ovary also. So at this stage, the doctor should have taken the exceeding consent as well. Unauthorized additional surgery, although may be time saving, may be less pain, less suffering, less expensive to the patient, the doctor said to me, but you cannot take it in defense in the court. The only exception, if it is a life-saving operation, then you can avoid the consent. And patient has the right on his body that you should ask him to take his consent. So doctor should communicate all the risk involved if in between the surgery one has to take. If the patient is conscious, take from the conscious patient or his husband or the other parents, that close relative. So mother consent not valid in absence of emergency. Correct appropriate procedure doesn't legal procedure. For the respondent, the court said the doctor acted in excess, but he acted in good faith. So, but the compensation was for unauthorized extended surgery, 25,000 only. What is express written consent? The court in the judgment in H.S. Tuli case, they said that all major diagnostic procedures, all major, general anesthesia, surgical operation, intimate examination, all medical cases, all examination for age and potency, virginity or HIV testing, one should take the cases. One question about the negative consent. Sometime the patient may not give a consent for a particular procedure, particular treatment. So this is called a negative consent. Refusal by the patient means that he doesn't want to give a consent. Sometime if you explain to the patient all the detail and patient may psychologically be disturbed. In that case, you should call the immediate relative of the patient. And the negative consent should be taken in the writing. It should be signed by the witnesses, because the patient has got a right on his body, on his part, and he can refuse the consent. Now about the documents. Now there is a question, the documents, the case file, and the history, whether the patient can take it or not. It is the property of the hospital. But on written request of the patient, MCI says you should provide this within 72 hours. Although you can keep some fee or some charges, minimal charges for this, handing over these documents. And you should take their signature that I have received this case file, and you should number it from 1 to whatever the number, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, whatever is in the case file. And you should take in writing that I have received from in full documents. There should be no correction after in the file. You don't know whether patient might have taken the photostat when the patient was admitted and the file was on the bed head of the patient. So later on, you don't do any manipulation. Then confidentiality of the patient should be maintained. The patient has got a right in case the, and you have to give the document. You cannot, don't give to any relative. don't give to any friend. If the consumer court or police ask you for the, or the insurance company ask for the file or the document, you cannot refuse. You take them in again in the writing, maintain a copy or a photostat for your future course of action and the record. And the record should be very complete, no overwriting, no change of the pen or signature, chronological order or comprehensive. How long to keep the record? Whether indoor record, OPD record, MTP, medical record, death certificate, operation note. As per the MCI, they say OPD record, we have to maintain up to 3 years. Indoor up to 5 years, and medical legal cases about 30 years. What about in pediatric cases? If child admitted, and let us say child is case of birth asphyxia, he developed sequelae of it, parents can file a case, the child can file a case. So the child when attained the age of adulthood, like 18 year plus 3 year, so in a child, you have to maintain the record up to 21 year of the age. This is very, very important. And what to do after that, 3 year, 5 year, 30 year, 18 year, or 21 year. Then you have to, if you want to destroy the record, or you want to delete from your computer or the record, then you have to give a notice in the press, in the newspaper, that so and so records are being destroyed. If anybody has any objection, so you have to give this in press. This is a case of over-documentation. Over-documentation is also not very good, like documentation. This child was admitted for some operation. He was given anesthesia at 10 a.m. Child become had cardiac arrest after half an hour. Child expired. Attendant, the parents went to court. When the record was summoned, there were two progress cards of the same patient on two separate paper. Why two anesthetists were there? It was not written, not explained on the paper. Name of the patient was not mentioned on the operation note on the paper. So hospital was accountable. Here they found that there is some fishy play. And the patient, why the anesthetist was called? So it was negligence was proved. If it was called, one should have mentioned that this was the reason I called for my help, and this was this distress. So everything should have been done. So patient, doctor should have been saved. So this is the import of a over-documentation also. Now, P.S. Grewal case versus C.S. Chawla. This is an accidental case, and the surgery of the shoulder joint was done. It was dislocation and rotator cuff injury. And after the surgery, the pain persisted. Expert opinion was sought. The expert said that this is due to accident and not to the axillary nerve damage and not to the surgery. In this case, the negligence was not on the part of the surgeon, but it was a sequelae of the accident. But in this case, what the court observation? They say not maintaining a proper record. Doctor did not mention anywhere in the record. So they say this is high time for doctor to write correct notes, operation record, discharge something. And document to be available to the patient is a matter of right. So in this case, the 10,000 cost of the said deficiency was analyzed on the doctor. So friends, what to do in this scenario? Two right thing. You should have a very clear conscious what you are going to do, and you can smell it, what is going to happen from the patient. Whether what are the type of attendant, so now you should do it. But you should have morality and the rules, rapport with the patient and the other. Here I say PPPI, you know, protein pump inhibitors, as anticipated are using, I made abbreviation PPPI. So you should make a rapport with the politician, for the police, for the prosecutor. Prosecutor means lawyers. Because they can help you at the time, whenever they need. So you should have rapport. Then I is inspector. Inspectors are very, very important. Now recently in Rohtak, one municipality inspector came to the doctor. He fined them ₹2,000. They say there was no proper distancing between patients, and patients were not wearing the mask. So a doctor explained to it, but the inspector fined. The inspector, they are very, very important. Inspector may be income tax inspector, may be police inspector, may be PNDT inspector, or any inspector. So this is advice you should make rapid with them. Then you should have a proper knowledge. You should attend CME, proper, you should have a note of gadgets, and again, the quality of medical graduation. Then you should have insurance. With IMA, IAP, and medical cell, Emilia, as Dr. Tiwari has said, they are doing PAC, personal accident coverage, and there are many doctors, they have taken it. Now, use of newer gadgets. What is legality of the CCTV? It is must in your setup. Especially for the time patient says, recently there was a case in the nursing home, and the attendant said, कि डॉक्टर साहब जो है हमारे को रात को देखने के लिए नहीं आए, पेशेंट सीरियस था. इट वॉज प्रूव इन दी सीसीटीवी डेट 2 AM इन द नाइट द डॉक्टर वॉज सीन इन दी सीसीटीवी. सो द टाइम ऑफ एग्जामिनेशन द डॉक्टर अवेलेबल इज वेरी गुड, बट ऑन द सेम टाइम डोंट मिस यूज द रिकॉर्डिंग.
डॉक्टर सतीश आपका टाइम
लास्ट लाइन
या
द लाइट. सिमिलरली स्मार्टफोन डिस्चार्ज कार्ड शुड बी पेशेंट फ्रेंडली. Death certificate will be discussed. Then the format for the prescription should be A4 size. Doctor name, qualification, registration number, addresses, and treatment in chronological order, all you know. And the pharmacist should sign and put a stamp the how many medicine he has prepared. The size of the prescription pad should be A4 size or 11x11 cm. Now these are the direction from the Medical Council of India to the all state. Dr. Tiwari was said that we should not take consent in corona. This consent we have made for the hospital declaration by the parents. That he has come in the wake of corona infection, I come to the hospital by myself as an emergency treatment. If I have been asymptomatic carrier, undiagnosed patient with COVID-19, I suspect it may be a danger, maybe to danger doctor, hospital staff. It is my responsibility to take appropriate precaution to follow the protocol. Similarly, myself and any of my family member I am residing with is not suffering from any symptom, and I know that I may get infection from the hospital, I will not hold the responsibility. So I am did it in English as well as Hindi. Patient signature and on side is doctor signature, mobile number, and some doctor are taking Aadhaar card. This we are doing in the hospital. Patient enter, because the municipality corporation, the health inspector staff, they are visiting your hospital, whether you are taking due precaution or not. On the chair, altered chair, this cross that you sit here, no patient like this. Then I want to add here, these days I am using a PP, not exactly PP here, and I am doing vaccination with the record. Because one time a patient came to me, Dr. Sir, aapne, you have given a wrong injection. I give an injection on the left side, patient developed an abscess on the right side because of any reason, maybe. And he came to me, you have given me injection. So at least these days, particularly I am maintaining the record, because the patient parents, they also think that we may also get a COVID from the hospital, from the doctor, my children may get. So at least you have a record that I am wearing the PPE and the doctor is not responsible. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sharma, for simplifying the complex issues. With this, I would like to now invite Dr. V.P. Singh, who is a professor of forensic medicine in Dayanand Medical College. And he is one of the authority in this part of country on the medical legal issues. And over to Dr. V.P. Singh for talking about record and death record and documentation.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the introduction. And now I will be sharing my slide, and my presentation is on declaration and issuing of death certificates.
Dr. Singh,
my slides are visible.
Yeah, slide show pe kar dijiye se.
Yeah, it is.
That's fine.
Yeah, it is on.
That's fine.
Yeah. Okay, so these are the three topics on which I will be speaking. First is declaration and issuing of death certificates, how to handle death in operation theater, and brought in dead cases. So first is declaration of death. So this topic we can divide into routine cases and those patients who are on ventilatory support. So as doctors, we all know that in routine cases, if the heart, respiration, and brain stops functioning, we declare that the patient is dead. But in case, if the patient is on ventilatory support, there is some controversy about the time we can declare that the patient has died. So this controversy is due to the legal provisions as per Indian law. So we will discuss what are the provisions of law regarding the death. So these are three different laws that describe what is death. So Registration of Birth and Death Act, Indian Penal Code Section 46, and Transplantation of Human Organs Act. So we will be discussing these definitions and try to find out what controversy is there and what is the reason why it is a challenge these days to declare when the patient is dead. So first is as per the RBD Act. So death is defined as permanent disappearance of all evidence of life. So this red font is important that there is disappearance of all evidence of life. That means circulatory, respiratory, and nervous system. So there can be a case scenario in which if a person is brain dead, but respiration and heart is supported artificially, so could be considered as alive as per this definition of this act of registration of births and deaths. So we as doctors use this definition of death to declare that the person has died. The second provision regarding death is as per the Indian Penal Code. So death denotes death of a human being unless the contrary appears from the context. So this definition is not telling us anything about what is death. And the third, very important, is Transplantation of Human Organs Act. So according to this, a diseased person is one in whom there is permanent disappearance of all evidence of life by reason of brain death or cardiopulmonary sense. So either of two, if stops, we label it that the person is dead. But we utilize this definition only for the cases of organ transplantation and not in other cases. In all other cases, we utilize this definition to declare that the patient has died. So to conclude this, we can say that there is lack of uniformity in declaring the moment of death. And what are the consequences of this lack of uniformity? Doctors wait till all evidence of life is lost. Before declaring the death, they have to wait. If brain death is there and other two vital systems are working due to any reason like ventilatory support, they will not declare that the patient has died. So this leads to delay in declaration of death, ultimately resulting in lack of trust in the society. So this lack of trust or controversy about declaration of death, so this we can see, this is known to all the doctors, this TV show of Satyamev Jayate. So this TV show has done much harm to the image of doctors, and we all have reacted to this. So in this, Amir Khan is saying that we hear stories of how hospitals keep clinically dead people alive on ventilators, either to make money or under pressure of family members. So this is a very derogatory statement against the doctors. But if we go to the root cause of this, so somewhere this is telling us about the mindset of the society. What is the suspicion in the society? So that we have to understand. So this root cause of this thing is due to the controversy about the declaration of death. So similarly, in this movie, Gabbar is Back. So this scene, Akshay Kumar rushes to a hospital with a person who is already dead. And in this movie, it was shown that doctors pretend to treat a dead body. Again, somewhere it is showing some suspicion in the society. The root cause for this, again, is due to some controversy about the declaration of death. So all these problems are in those cases in which patient is on ventilatory support. So these items are there. Is very interesting. In the medical records, now doctors have to write such things that family had doubts regarding the alive status of the patient. So they were explained that the patient is on ventilatory support and is sedated as for now. So the patient's relatives were shown the vitals of the patient. They were made to palpate the pulse of the patient. So this suspicion is there whether the patient is alive or the patient is dead. So all these controversies are there due to non-uniformity of the legal provisions. So is there any solution to this? So yes, there is a suggestion. There should be uniform definition of death in all the legislations. So brain death should be included as a form of death in the RBD Act. So in that act, death may be defined as permanent and irreversible cessation of either circulatory and respiratory functions or brain stem functions. So if there is uniformity in the legal provisions, then all the controversies can be solved. So after declaration of death, the next duty of a doctor is to certify death. So as per this Registration of Birth and Death Act, registration of births and deaths is mandatory as per law. The doctor is required to issue medical certificate of cause of death. So that in short is known as MCCD. And complete information in MCCD is required for registration of death. So this is a duty of a doctor to certify death. So once death is declared and certified, then it is to be informed. So there are various forms as per this act in which death information is to be provided. Form 2 and 3 are regarding the death report and stillbirth report. So this is given, this information is sent by the doctor or the informant to the registrar of local authorities. The third one is a MCCD Act. This MCCD form, it can be Form 4 or 4A. Which depending upon whether the death is institutional or it is non-institutional. So the last one is the death certificate. It is issued by the registrar or the local authorities. So there is a misconception that death certificate is issued by doctors. Actually, death certificate is not issued by doctors. It is based on the information sent by the doctor that death certificate is issued by the registrars. We as doctors are issuing MCCD, Medical Certificate of Cause of Death. So it is important to understand that in which cases doctor cannot issue MCCD. What is the cause of death certificate that cannot be issued? So these are all the unnatural deaths. It can be homicide, suicide or accident or suspicious death where exact cause of death is not known to the doctor. In broad death cases, in all these cases, we cannot hand over body to the relatives. Body is to be handed over to the police for medico-legal autopsy and MCCD cannot be issued. So the simple rule for doctors to understand is that doctors should not issue MCCD unless he witnessed the death and knows what is the cause of death. So this has a legal implication whether we can issue death certificate or not. So death certificate here means MCCD. Then how to fill MCCD? So this is a cause-related mortality rate, which is going to decide what are the health policies of the nation. So we have to give the exact cause of death, which can be utilized to take the strategic decisions by the government. So this cause of death, we can divide it into part one and part two. So part one has line A, B, and C. In this, we fill up the immediate cause in the uppermost line of part one. If this immediate cause is due to some other comorbid condition, that is known as antecedent cause. And in the last line of part one, we have to write down what is the underlying cause. So this column is to be filled from below upwards. So first of all, we will write down what is the underlying cause, which initiated the sequence of events leading to death. So quickly we can again revise what is to be filled in line A. So write the condition or disease that led directly to the death. But here a caution is there that do not write the mode of death, like circulatory failure, respiratory failure. These things are not to be written because they are not giving any information about the immediate cause. So if immediate cause occurred due to some other cause, then it is to be written as antecedent cause in line B. And in line C, or last line of part one, we have to write a disease or condition that started the sequence of events. So that is to be written. So this is an example in case there is fall from stairs. So first of all, we will start from here, from lower, and then we will fill up the columns above this. This fall from stairs led to fracture neck of femur, ultimately resulting to hypostatic pneumonia, causing death of a person. So similarly, in part two, we have to mention the contributory causes of death. So these are other morbid conditions or injuries present at the time of death, which are not related to the causes listed in part one. They are not related to part one, but they are present in addition to part one category. And these contributed in some way to the outcome of death. So this is how we can fill up this MCCD form. So this is all about my first topic of declaration and certification of the death. So next is death on operation table. So what do we mean by this? So it is a condition in which patient dies in OT before the surgery could be completed, or just at the end of an otherwise technically successful surgery. So this death on table is a very complicated medico-legal situation. We can correlate this with the death in police custody. If somebody dies in police custody, there is always a suspicion that police must have done something. So similarly, if death occurs in operation theater, there is a chance that always there will be suspicion in the mind of relatives that something negligent must have done. So that is the reason why we lost our patient. So there is a risk of litigation of criminal negligence in such cases. There is a risk of violence against the doctor or the hospital. And there is always a risk of arrest under Section 304A, Indian Penal Code. So this is a case in which death occurs as rash or negligent act, not amounting to culpable homicide. So doctors must be, specifically surgeons must be very much clear and prepared for how to handle such cases. So agitated relatives may turn into a mob suddenly. They may create a disaster for the hospital. Police may register a case under Section 304A and can arrest the doctor. So sometimes, just to calm down the mob, police will arrest the doctor. Even if it is illegal or unlawful, police is doing such things, practically we all know from experience. So here I want that all the doctors must know this Jacob Matthews case. It is like Bible or Gita for all the doctors. So this is a Supreme Court guidelines on criminal negligence. And from my presentation, if all the doctors can get one message, is this message that I want to convey. The gist of this case is that private complaint may not be entertained unless the complainant has produced prima facie evidence in the form of credible medical opinion to support the charge of rashness or negligence by the accused doctor. So here we need to understand what we mean by private complaint. So private complaint, it is a complaint in which complainant can directly go to the court and file a complaint. No further requirement is there. But in case there is a case of criminal negligence against a doctor, private complaint will not be entertained. So that attendant of the patient has to produce credible medical opinion. And for the investigating officers, before proceeding against the doctor, IO must get an independent and competent medical opinion, preferably from the doctor in government service, qualified in that branch of medical practice who can be expected to give an impartial and unbiased opinion. So this is for the police to understand that without this medical opinion, they cannot arrest a doctor. They cannot proceed further with the investigation. So this is by the Supreme Court, and all doctors must have printout of this in their clinics, hospitals, and they must know about their rights. So what are the medical legal issues that come up in the death in operation theaters? The first point is that it is a prerogative of a doctor to decide whether the case is MLC or not. So the other school of thought says that as per section 39 CRPC, all the deaths on table are to be reported to the police. But I personally feel that this is not the case. It is the prerogative of the doctor to decide whether it is MLC or it is non-MLC. But then how to decide it is MLC or not? So this can be decided if the relatives are satisfied in case death occurs in OT. If relatives are satisfied, then there is no need to inform the police. Because doctor has not committed any crime, death can occur as a complication of the surgery. But advice here is that take in writing from the relatives that we do not want postmortem of our patient and the treating doctor was not negligent in doing the surgery. So that thing should be taken in writing. Later on, it can help to the doctors. The other scenario can be if relatives are aggressive and from the circumstances you can make out that later on they will complain. It is better to inform the police on your own. So if you inform the police, then it will become a medical legal case. And if you do not inform, then the relatives will file a complaint against you. And then it will be very ugly thing for a doctor to handle. It's better to inform on your own if you feel that patient relatives are aggressive. And in such a case, we cannot hand over the body to the relatives. Body is to be handed over to the police and then medical legal postmortem will be done. But it is not required that in all cases we have to inform the police. It is not required. So then once you inform the police, it becomes medical legal case. Then police will come to the hospital for panchnama. Then how to handle that? So these are some tips regarding that. Provide all the information to the police in writing. Because if you speak out something, there is a chance that misinterpretation can be there, which can be willingly or unwillingly. So give everything in writing. Never refuse to give the medical records to the police. So the implication of this thing is that your medical records should be up to date all the time. So side by side, when you are treating a patient, your medical records should be full. Only then you can provide it if there is a sudden death of a patient and suddenly you have to hand over the records. You should be confident enough that everything is written in the medical record. So number all the documents that you hand over to the police. Keep a copy of every page that you are giving to the police with you also. And take acknowledgement from the police, whatever you are handing over or whatever information you are giving in writing. But there can be a chance when information is to be given on phone. So in that condition, keep record of the information that you provided, because later on you will forget what you said. It's better you write it on a piece of paper, preserve that piece of paper, and also note down the name and designation of police officer to whom you informed on phone. So these are the medical legal points. So next is the actual handling of the situation. When death has occurred in operation theater, you are still in OT, how to handle the situation. So before you declare the death, intraoperative, when you are in a operation theater and a dead body is lying in front of you, so very important is don't panic or shout at the juniors. Because if you are shouting or creating a panic, so that message is definitely going out to the relatives. And that will definitely create a suspicion that something wrong has occurred inside the operation theater. So you have to maintain your calm. You have not committed any crime. So death can occur in operation theater. So that thing you should keep in mind. So there should be no expired drugs in the operation theater. You have to check the broken ampules in case there is a broken ampule in which expiry date has passed. You have to replace that ampule with the other one. It's not that you just pick up and then it should not be available. You have to replace it with the new broken ampoule that indicates that the expiry is still there. You have to check the crash cart also. Don't clear the operation theater. So whatever is there, keep it as such. So, but if something that is directly implicating the surgeon, that can be modified, but otherwise rest of the scene should appear as it is original. So these are the things that we have to keep in mind. Complete all the document very quickly. There are few minutes for you. After that, you have to declare the death. So in that time, you have to complete your surgery, anesthesia notes, nursing care, resuscitation, consent. So whatever is left, you can fill up at that time. But that is possible only if your major part of documentation is already complete. So before breaking the bad news, you have to gather your support system. You can call your colleagues. Security guards should be alert, but they should remain calm. In case there is some agitation, they should be able to handle that. After doing all this, then you can declare. So how to break up bad news? Don't ask your juniors to inform, because there is a chance that they are less experienced, they will mess up everything. It is ideal that doctors and administrators of the hospital, they should inform, and never talk to the mob. If there are 15, 20 people standing in front of you, it is advisable not to talk to them. Any of them can become aggressive, and then there will be a very difficult situation for the doctor or hospital to handle. So select few leader relatives or those who are agitating the most. Counsel them in a room with CCTV camera. Don't make a statement that proves you guilty. Even if you are empathetic, but be very calculative in the words that you speak. Nothing should indicate that there is some guilt from you, because they will always misuse that thing in a court of law later on. So they may be recording everything, whatever you are speaking may be recorded in their mobile phones. Be confident, give clear and precise information of the sequence of events, because if you yourself are confused or if you appear to be confused, is definitely going against you. Whatever you want to say, make up your mind what information or story you want to tell, and then you have to inform and you have to tell that this was a complication. So handling the situation of violence. You have to save yourself first from the violence. In case violence starts or it is impending that in few minutes or in some time there can be some destruction in the hospital, you have to call senior police officer for help. Consult your lawyer for anticipatory bail if it is required. Never argue with a mob. And in case you feel that things are becoming uncontrollable, it is better to exit from the site. So these are the practical points that surgeon should be prepared well in advance. At that time, it will be difficult for surgeon to understand or to make out what is to be done. If the surgeon is already prepared that if such type of condition occurs, what is to be done? So there can be situation where a doctor has to communicate with the press. So if a press comes to you, never try to avoid the press. Take it as an opportunity to clarify the suspicion or the doubt through the media. So that is a chance, that is a mouthpiece of a doctor, that in case that news goes in a television, so whatever reasonable care, diligent treatment you have provided, what were the complications that you could not avoid or control, all those things you can inform. And only designated representative should communicate. Decide with your team the information to be shared, and that person should be telling that information. So if the situation becomes serious, so it may be required that you go to the press, arrange for a press conference. If it is becoming a national crisis, if that case is by chance becoming so popular in the society, so then you have to clarify your point. You can arrange for a press conference and explain the sequence of events. So this is all about how to handle the death in operation theater. So my last topic is, so quickly I will finish this topic of brought in dead cases. The patient is found to be already clinically dead on arrival to the hospital. So these are the brought in dead cases. what are the medical legal duties of a doctor in such a case? The first duty is to declare death. So don't be in hurry to declare that the person has died. Be sure. Look for the vitals, whether the patient is alive or dead. If you have done CPR and you are sure that the patient is dead, only then declare death. MCCD cannot be issued in such cases because you have not witnessed the death. You don't know what is the cause of death. It is to be labeled as a MLC. Once the case has entered in the record of the hospital, then you have to label it as medical legal case. Police information is must. The second thought is that in case that patient was earlier treated by the doctor, had gone home and has again come for the treatment, and in the transit or at reaching the hospital he died, doctor can decide to issue a death certificate, MCCD certificate. But that is a tricky situation. It is a bit risky also, that you don't know what happened during transit. Some crime might have committed, so it is always better to inform the police and tell the relatives, let the police decide whether postmortem is required or not. The body is to be handed over to the police and not to the relatives. But by chance, if there is a resistance by the relatives and they are resisting to hand over the body to the mortuary, then you cannot physically stop them. It is just let them take away the body. You have to inform the police at the earliest that the relatives are taking away the body. It is a medical legal case. Then police will decide what is to be done. You are not going to fight with the relatives. So with this, I will end by saying that medical legal awareness is must for all doctors. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. VP Singh. You have brought so many facts which even we were not aware, and such a short span of time. And I do hope that all of our colleagues which are dealing with these sudden deaths, all of them, they are benefited. And now let me take you in the next 15 minutes briefly about the telemedicine, and then we'll take the question answer session, and kindly be with us by that time.
Yes, sir.
So as we all know, these are the recent guidelines issued by the Ministry of Health, and I'm not going to read this definition, but I'll just read the first line. This is a delivery of healthcare services where distance is a critical factor by all healthcare professionals, and they are using information and communication which is available with us right at this time. And this is basically the delivery of healthcare services. As we discussed, the distance is a critical factor. That's why this telemedicine came into existence, and it was started way back in 1994. And a few of the leading hospitals, they are providing two services to number of states in the country.
Dr. Singh, stop sharing, Dr. Singh.
My audio is not there?
Yeah, your video is not there. Yeah.
Video?
PPT. PPT?
PPT.
Yeah. Dr. Singh has to stop sharing.
Okay. Just wait.
Dr. Varinder, kindly stop the share.
Yeah, I have stopped.
Second will be.
No, it's okay.
Video available, Dr. Sharma?
Yeah, both are.
PPT?
Yeah.
So just to continuing, this is by all healthcare professionals using communication technology which are available with us. And it is in the interest of advancing of health of all individuals. And this is the way, this is basically we are using one way, we are both way, doctor and patient are communicating, and we are taking the help of technology right now, which is available. And we have one more synonymous term which is in use as such, that's a telehealth. So let's learn what is telehealth. It generally provided training. These are composed of administrating meetings and continue medical education. And at the same time, the people also provide clinical services. But it is taken care of, more of the chunk is taken by telehealth as we look into. And when we look into telemedicine, this as I discussed for the remote services, there are more differences between the two. So basically telehealth, you have a team, there's a clinician and nurse, we treat and most of the time it is in the institutional context and focus is on the patient, and you can do both control and monitoring of these patients, which we are not going to do when we are looking into telemedicine services, because these telemedicine services are at user led, and what we are providing, either we are providing at our community context or as we are looking into e-Sanjeevani context, when we have a few designated hospital where a patient will come to one distant place, and then we have a specialist sitting over here who discuss and then we share. So just to look into the telehealth, refer to the remote delivery and facilitation of health and health related services, including medical care provider and patient education. Whereas, and we are taking help of both telecommunication and digital communication technology. So what is the scope of practice? As we discussed in the beginning of presentation, this pandemic. So it's important that all our colleagues and regulators, they are supposed to adhere to the same concept when it comes to the visit and what they are. So physician is not going to comprise the standard of care, meaning thereby that when whether we are dealing with a patient in a virtual context or in person, so it has to be at the same time. But look into that, it must be important as equal to in-person assessment of that individual or patient. So there are certain guiding principle which has been laid down by ministry. So where doctor should be well positioned to decide whether this patient is going to need a tele-based consultation or in-person review is needed, and then he or she has to exercise proper discretion and should not compromise on the quality of care. This is very important. And this has fallen as part of, we all know that we are all registered medical practitioners. They are covered under IMC Act of 1956, which regulation 2000 deals with professional conduct, etiquette and ethics. And it has been recently amended in March 2020. So we have the standard of care every institution having, either they are provided by the institutions or by the professional bodies like IMA, IAP, obstetrics and others, and sometimes we have those which our peers they decide. So important is when we are providing telemedicine services to look for appropriate documentation, as we looked by Dr. Sri Sharma, when we are dealing with any patient, patient identification is very important. So keep a record of text, audio, images. I'll share there what are the technology which we can use and ensure storage of this all information. And this is one of the well-developed center. I have taken this photograph from Institute of Healthcare Professional Training Program and how low these things are provided. But important, as we deal in day-to-day practice, it's important to look into the patient's privacy. So look that there should not be any third party use, no improper storage, and user data has to be maintained, and this is very important. Otherwise, if it is mishandled at the point of a healthcare professional, then he is liable to be misconduct. And remember, we are using number of technology as on today, so there are certain limitations one should be aware when you are providing. So sometime there may be some difference in the image resolution because of the accuracy. So it's very important to look into that area, and reliability and timeliness is also going to affect the quality of these services. So one need to be careful. So there are standard of care, privacy and security, consent, documentation, licensing when we are providing these services. So standard of care depends on the circumstances where somebody is dealing with. So it's recommended by the ministry as well as the Medical Council of India that one healthcare person has to consider the patient best interest. And remember, we had this judgment in 2018 when the Honorable High Court of Bombay created an uncertainty about the place and leisure telemedicine because there was no appropriate framework was not existing at that time. And now we are lucky this telemedicine services has been legalized. So there are four types of application. Let's discuss about them. So how can we discuss with a patient? Either it could be video, audio or text messages. And what about timing? One could be real time or it could be asynchronous, that patient has sent the message and the doctor is going to respond later on or at time. Third one is the purpose. So there are going to be three type of visit. One could be the first consult visit, follow consult, and emergency. So why is important to understand? Because for the first time of visit, there are a certain requirement which need to be met, which we are going to discuss. And individual, it could be three ways. Either could be between patient and doctor, or some doctor is sitting and he is talking to the patient, and that information is being shared by the treating physician or an expert. Or sometime it could be healthcare worker or caregiver, and between the doctor. So these are the four ways how we are going to talk about. So what are the ways? So one is the video, because this gives more of the information. Real time interaction is there. Patient identification is also easier. And doctor can visualize the patient and discuss. And all visual clues, if somebody would like to look into, they can be perceived and discuss. And even with the experienced person who are dealing with this, inspection of the patient can also be done. Other medium is the audio. So it is convenient and fast, because the video, you need to have a smartphone and a good network connectivity, which could not be there most of the time. And audio is has got unlimited reach. And importantly, it is being emphasized again and again in the literature that it is suitable for the urgent cases, and you need not to have infrastructure, as we discussed, that otherwise in a setup you need to have number of gadgets, and at the same time it is ensuring the privacy, and we can also have real-time interaction. Third one modality is the text one. Texting is convenient and quick, but documentation identification one has to be looked into. So this is recommended for urgent cases, or when patient is turning off follow-up, or sometime for second opinion when somebody has provided one information and people would like to look into. So this is seven elements which has been recommended by the Institute of Healthcare Providers. Before any telemedicine consultation, we should look into all those seven elements. First is the context, how it's going to be provided. Both identification of RMP and patient has to be there. What is the mode of communication? Followed by consent, type of consultation which patient is going to look into, and then finally evaluate the patient, and then one has to generate the slip and then to discard. So which tool we can use as on today? So there are number of devices, like we can use a telephone, videos as we discuss, or if they are a facility, then LAN, internet, mobile or landline, they also can be used. These are all approved by those recent guidelines. There are certain chat platforms like WhatsApp, Facebook Messenger, Google One, and there are internet digital like Skype, email and fax. These all can be used. What one need to be careful when we are having this data and using these technology, sometime there may be chances of breach of or data leakage. So one need to be very careful, because we are dealing with this situation, because Zoom is under this Zoom platform is right at the scrutiny because of the leakage of data. So how to look into when we start providing these services? So kindly look into the complete detail of the patient, like a name, age and everything. A registered ID has to be taken care of, and the doctor has to introduce along with his name and qualification. And it is recommended in this guidelines that the doctor has to display his or registration number, which should be accessible as per to all on all the prescriptions. And consent, as we discussed initially, there are two issues here. If in the beginning patient initiate the telemedicine consultation, then consent is implied one, or there could be other one that is explicit if sometime the doctor is going to initiate the telemedicine consult. So these are both way how we are going to look into the consent issue. So remember, physical examination is very critical as we deal for all information and consultation. So one should not proceed until unless, because that's again one of the issues, otherwise that will go beyond ethics or somebody may be held liable. If we are not having facility for inpatient consult, or if that person or patient has to be examined by another doctor or health worker, and or third one is video consultation. So these are the three recommendations where one is to look into. There are certain more issues which one need to look into. So as we are dealing with other patients when we are doing them physical examination, so please maintain all patient record, including case history, if somebody has shared those investigation reports, images, etc., as appropriate for each case. and then prescribe medications. If we prescribe medications without appropriate diagnosis or provisional diagnosis like people do, that as per these guidelines, it amounts to professional misconduct. So one need to be careful. And at the same time, it's very important to protect the privacy and confidentiality of these patients. Otherwise, that treating physician can be held liable in the court of law. So when to write medications, there are certain guidelines which are given for these guys, which are covered under these guidelines. Once is the treating physician is fully satisfied about the patient medical condition. Secondly, which are in the best interest of the patient, because sometimes there may be conflict. So there are again certain medications which only a doctor can prescribe when we are doing these telemedicine services, like there is one list zero, like over-the-counter drugs, paracetamol, ORS, or sometime a patient has visited a doctor for a follow-up because that is valid as per this guideline for 6 months. So one can re-prescribe or a refill for the same medication which he was initially prescribed in the physical visit. Or when there are same medications for the same condition, if somebody would like to, when these patients are turning up. And never and never, never and never, please do not write these drugs which are Schedule X. When we look into these guidelines, there are no schedules here like H or H1. There is only Schedule X. So that emphatically say that no narcotic or psychotropic substances has to be prescribed when we are giving these telemedicines. So what is the way how we are going to share? Write, click the image, and then send what's the medium with us with that. There are certain doubts in telemedicine. So there could be some time delay. There are some protocols which are relating to physician-patient relationship, issues of liability and negligence, which we are going to discuss in the coming slide. Informed consent we look, and especially to keep these medical records and medication, which we already discussed. So now the next important question comes, is it this telemedicine safe to practice? Or can doctor be sued for negligence if something happens beyond that? So remember, as on these guidelines say that you can safely practice, telemedicine safe to practice, but with one rider, that one need to follow all those teleconsultation guidelines which are available on the ministry's website, and one need to look into, and there are certain frequently asked questions because for want of time we cannot take them. So, but if we breach those, then a doctor can be sued for. So there are certain strategies, and briefly they are taken into 7 spheres. So one is confirm this compliance of guidelines which are available in your place. Talk to the client about technology and try to create a confidential environment, and conduct the session from a private professional environment. And one need to practice when we wanted to, because there are few of our colleagues, we are only providing telemedicine consultation, and it's important to prioritize self-care, and every time just try to look into a safety plan in the place. So there are certain examples briefly I like to discuss. Sometime when the doctor will insist to telemedicine consultation, but when the patient is willing to travel for in-person consultation, so that will amount to an act of misconduct. And if doctor is found to be misusing patient images or data, and the doctor prescribe medication which I said Schedule X, which is not in the restricted list, and it's again in this provision, in these guidelines, there is no provision for soliciting patient for telemedicine through any advertisement. So what we can do, so anytime if there is a breach, if a doctor want, he is not able to satisfy or not able to complete the examination, so both of them as a RMP or a doctor or a physician can in between leave also. And if a patient has would like to discontinue the teleconsult, they both of them, they are protected in these guidelines, so they can terminate those in between. So there are certain advantages of telemedicine. One, it provides equal access to quality of care even at a remote places. So there's, because people are not going to travel, so there's going to saving of cost and effort. And during this time when we wanted to have very less number of footfall in the busy OPD and areas where we are getting more patients, and so because we are keeping everything, so there's every likelihood that we are going to maintain record and documentation, and at the same time patient can access his treating physician in a timely manner. So basically this brief purpose, this module was just to give practical advice or guidelines or tips to our colleagues. So before that, when we are jumping over to these telemedicine, because we are also providing, so please take care of and exercise reasonable care, skill and judgment before taking on all these precautions and sharing all this with our patients. So we are here for you, and generally in why I put this slide is because in Western countries there are all associations, like in our place IMA, IAP and others are doing. So all those professional associations are here too. So one need to take their help if there is a need be. So with this we
question.
Okay, so we have with my permission of my co-faculty, I would like to discuss, and there were specific questions which we have prepared. So I like to permission of my co-faculty and another 5 minutes. We would like to discuss one in this section 2.
Yes, sir.
Can I go ahead, Dr. Satish?
Yes, okay.
So we have, there were a few queries which were raised in one of other in-house meetings. So people wanted to know what is this section 269 of IPC. So basically, because as we are, we all know this epidemic act is in force and everywhere. So this section is says that if somebody can be likely to spread the infection or any disease, so he can be punished with imprisonment of either description, which can extend up to 6 months with fine or both. This is section 269, so one need to look into, and this is a cognizable offense but bailable, and any magistrate can do. And remember, in certain states there has been some issues, like we are coming, like we know that there are few our friends or person who are traveling for other places, and they are going to be kept in a separate or a designated. And when we have travel history from other places, where already COVID-19 cases are there, and it's again this guidelines say that it is mandatory to clean or disinfect any part of these places where these patients are kept, and nobody can say no to this. And remember, these are again guidelines, because we see, as Dr. Satish was sharing, that people are coming, like so assessment, and when we are not having those social distancing, so they are going to taken care of and they are going to be penalized. And we know this because there are legal provision when we have health emergency, because in our lifespan we are seeing it. Earlier it was 1920, now we are seeing in 2020. So because this is already in place, so a person is liable upon conviction to a sentence of simple 1 month or fine or both. When we are looking into those health emergency, these are the legal response as per our constitution. And remember, there is protection to person acting under the act. No suit or other legal proceedings shall lie against any person for anything done in good faith handed to be done under this act. So this probably, this is the, these are the lines which protect all our healthcare workers who are working during this pandemic of COVID-19. So it's again very important to understand, these are the legal framework and legal immunity to us. Just to continue, this is actually a very old 1897 act which we are following in all district. And in this act, right now all the powers has been delegated to the district magistrates or deputy commissioner as their decision, and they are responsible for taking all decisions. And you can see that all these guidelines, or they come from them, so they are going to take all issues regarding guidelines for quarantine, entry and exit at ports or barriers or interstate barriers. So they are coming to look into, and that's why they are looking into all those issues. So there are a few practical questions which I would have taken and decided. In some states, government has ordered private doctors to work in COVID-19 hospital, and example is our state of Maharashtra, where one ordinance has been issued. So if some government comes with these guidelines, so as per the government dictate or MCIE, people has to follow this. They cannot say no to this. That's a brief answer. This, you cannot say that I'm not going to look into. Or those doctors who are in private practice, do they enjoy the legal rights of refusing the patient in this pandemic? Or can government invoke ESMA or on private doctors? So when I was talking in a few of our colleagues here in the legal fraternity, so these are IMC guideline 2005. This apply to all registered medical practitioners, and at the same time section 2 of Epidemic Act 1897 empowers all the state government to take suitable measure to prevent the spread of any epidemic. So what happens, what are the implication of these? So government can seek help of any person, or as per the section 65 of DMA Act, so they can invoke SMA if somebody refuses to work. But there are few riders. There are two issues: when a doctor's life is at risk, or when the patient is beyond his or her expectation to treat expert during emergency. So there are two situations when somebody, a doctor, can be and he is not going to help liable. So remember, in during pandemic, no doctor cannot refuse further treatment of a patient in any pandemic because of this DMA Act, which is and as per the section 5.2 of IMC regulation. So do not try to abandon his or her duty, and it's very important that if we come across any of these patients during this time, so it again becomes obligatory on the treating physician to notify the concerned authority, which are the district surveillance officer throughout country. And at the same time, these guidelines make us binding on us that no physician will arbitrarily refuse treatment to a patient. It is his obligation to the sick during the time of pandemic. So if you don't do, does it amount to a violation or misconduct? Okay, so that's why it amounts to that. That's why it should be, one should be aware of direction and guidelines of the government, which are issued time and time. And remember, they change from area to area. What we are having may not be applicable in the Maharashtra, or what is applicable in Maharashtra may not be applicable in Uttar Pradesh. One needs to look into what are the local guidelines which has been issued. So important question come, can we say no to a patient? No, because in some states already the doctor has been sued for not opening cleaning and treating patients, and every time we are getting, like it has happened in our neighboring state in Punjab and Haryana. So what a doctor has to do in these circumstances? But remember, there is no law on this earth which can force a person to take a risk of his or her life. So what does it mean? Because this is covered under Article 21 of Constitution, what does it mean? So doctor should inform the concerned authority about the non-availability of PPE and document, the reason for not opening the clinic. If you are having in this place and we are not having those appropriate PPEs which has as per the guidelines, so one can document these reasons until unless otherwise. And it is again recommended that one is supposed to put a notice in front of the clinic mentioning the reason why he or she is not opening the clinic, or that only then otherwise. But can the government force a doctor to work without PP, or what should a doctor of a private clinic when the PPs are not available? Then as per this Constitution Act, we are in a position to say no to the government. So government cannot force our colleague to work without PPs. And before that, there is one rider that we should have brought these deficiencies to the notice of higher authorities who are responsible for the management of this payment. And at the same time, again and again, it is important to re-emphasize that document and manage all those cases adequately with your available facility before referring them, as we were discussing. So it's important to follow all those guidelines. So that becomes important. So it is mandatory to follow the government order under the Epidemic Disease Act 1897. And I will request those who have logged in to just to go into this brief of this document. As we were discussing about certain important judgments of in medical legal cases by the Supreme Court as well as the national and the state commissions, because otherwise this is a punishable as per the section of 188 of IPC 1860, which can be imprisonment up to 6 months of fine and both. So what happens, it's a busy hospital and we are not able to identify a COVID-19 patient. So doctor is not liable because section of this epidemic, just one silver lining is there, that no suit or proceeding can be done against any person for anything done or intended to be done in the good faith, because what we are doing is a good faith, so our police cannot be looked into that. So with this, this is the last slide, and before we had a lot many questions, and I like to request all my esteemed panelists to take them one by one. So it's a marathon session, we are already considerable, and a lot many people are still logged on. So it becomes our moral and ethical duty to respond to their questions. I think my panelists will bear with me, and we are having very heavy rain in Shimla, and you can hear all those noises just from my chamber.
So there is one question from Dr. Kishore. Can we do sterilization procedure on a foreigner in India?
Dr. Tiwari, there is one very interesting question.
Yes. The question was not clear. Can you just repeat it?
Yeah. Sir, the question is, can we do sterilization operation on a foreigner in India?
Sterilization on foreigner in India.
Yes.
Definitely, if there is an indication, and if the patient is, we are doing the cardiac surgery and other surgeries, I think if there is a consent of the patient, we can do that. Only being a foreigner does not. I think Dr. Singh will agree. Only being a foreigner does not or is not a contraindication for doing sterilization surgery.
Yes, if the consent is there, then we can definitely operate upon the patient.
If he is willing, then we can do it.
Okay, sir. Sir, the next question is, in case a child of a snake bite comes and the attendants, because of ignorance, refuse the consent for the anti-snake venom, and so what should be done then?
So I think we cannot force upon the treatment on the patient. So we have to take a informed refusal, that everything has been informed, that what can be the consequence of not getting the treatment in the vernacular in which patient attendant can understand. That refusal should be taken, but we cannot forcefully give the antivenom, because antivenom has consequences which are negative to the patient also, and for that reason any treatment cannot be forced upon.
There was one more query from our colleagues which are beyond 65 years of age. Keeping in the mortality, morbidity and all these issues beyond 60 years of age, there was one question, can they stop running their clinics? Do we have any guidelines? Dr. Singh and Dr. Tiwari, what's your take on this?
Yeah, I think we can stop, but the thing should be informed to the authorities, like the civil hospital or the district hospital.
Okay.
Or the municipal authorities, we should inform that because of this reason we have stopped the clinic. I don't think there is any objection or any law which will force you to open your clinic if you are giving the genuine reason.
But as we know, looked into both this Epidemic Act and as well as the Medical Council of India Act, they are not mentioned this age. Because that's happened only during this pandemic, that there are certain age groups and with comorbid conditions that there are high risk of mortality. So what can be done during these situations?
Yes, this is not a law.
Yeah.
These are the guidelines. I think giving the reference of these guidelines, or giving the reference that there is a possibility of getting a COVID infection, being there are other comorbidities, and keeping in mind the age of the doctor, he can request. That's what I am saying. You should inform the authorities. Yes. That because of this, we are stopping the clinic. So unless and until there is real emergency and the authorities ask you to open the clinic, we can stop until there is a real emergency and there is an extreme need of the consultant or the doctor. So we can stop that.
Thank you, Dr. Tiwari. There's more questions.
Sir, can you explain what is zero FIR? Can it be made in case of pregnancy in minor when patient refuses FIR?
VP Singh sir, you would like to comment on this?
I am not aware about this, about zero FIR.
Zero FIR means even if it is not in the area is not under that police station, they can complain to that police station, and that FIR is known as zero FIR. And ideally, the FIR should be lodged.
Yeah, then it is transferred to the area where this crime has been committed. So basically, they take because it is transferred to that area. That's a zero FIR. Whether we can do it or not, I think we are not having an answer. And we'll request the participant to email us and we'll respond.
Sir, if the attendants or the patient is misbehaving with the doctor and staff, can a doctor deny him treatment?
This can be done in the subsequent illness, but in the present illness, you cannot deny, or you should not deny rather. Because if you deny, there will be further allegation that you have not done proper treatment. This time you have to treat that illness, like if he has been admitted for a typhoid case, fever is not subsiding, you are giving all the proper medicines and doing all the treatment, fever is not subsiding. So you have to treat even if the patient is not behaving properly. But next time when he becomes all right and after 1 or 2 months he comes for acute diarrhea or acute URI or for any other illness, you can say that last time you have misbehaved and now I am not going to treat your relative or your patient.
Okay, sir.
Yes.
Please.
So one thing that can be added is we should document this thing that the patient has behaved in a wrong manner. And we, in case we feel that it is very difficult to treat such a patient, we can give some notice to the patient that you arrange for some other care of the doctor. So till that time, I will be treating you. But within week, you can shift to some other doctor. So if you are misbehaving, I am not willing to treat you. You can document this thing and give a, don't stop treatment suddenly. Give some time, few days or few or a week at the most to shift over to some other doctor.
Yeah, I think we should tide over the acute emergency and then in the meantime should give them time. So they can, I think that will be.
Okay, sir. Sir, sometimes during admission, patients create nuisance and neither they give consent for admission and nor they take away the patients. So what can be done then?
So documentation is the only thing.
Yes, Singh sir, you please go ahead.
No, sir, you continue. So I just wanted to say that in that case, we have to document whatever patient or the attendants are doing. If they are not signing, if they are not refusing to sign, then we have to write down all those points. So that can be done. Dr. Tiwari sir wants to say.
Yeah, that is what I wanted to say. You have to document each and everything, even in the previous question where we said that the patient can be referred to a other center. So you have to document, and in this case also you have to document. But as we discussed in previous question, once you have admitted the child or the patient, in that particular admission you have to continue unless and until there is very serious disturbing doctor-patient relationship. Another thing which we can do, if the patient are giving lot of trouble to us, trying to create nuisance, we can inform the police and then we continue the treatment. So that option is also there with us, that we inform the police that these patients are creating trouble and we are continuing the treatment only because we have admitted this and we have taken responsibility of the care, but we are doing under this a lot of stress. And if something wrong happens, the patient will be equally responsible, because if you try everything and still the patients are creating nuisance, some responsibility should be shared by them also.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, there is one question. Yes, sir.
Inform the police and continue the treatment.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Sir, there is one question from Dr. Sitak. If there is a positive signs of death, like there is no heart rate, no respiration, pupils are dilated, non-reactive to light, and should we do CPR in those patients?
So if we are sure that the patient has died, then there is no purpose of doing CPR.
Okay, sir.
No, but CPR you will always do if it is in front of you. If the patient is brought dead, then you should not, you should try to avoid CPR, because patient may, or the relatives may have the doubt that the child die or the patient has died because of the CPR. But if the patient was under your care, I think CPR you must do in each and every case before labeling that patient as a dead patient, because you have tried to revive the patient. But if the patient has been brought dead, sometimes there can be problem, especially with the illiterate patient. Many times they feel that because you have given thumbs on the chest, the patient has died, or because you have given intracardiac adrenaline, the patient has died. Of course, all this can be defended in the court of law, but you will have some temporary problem, or you will have the problem of facing the court case or the allegation in the court that the relative died because of this CPR procedure.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
So, thank you. There are very long questions, so we are going to share our email ID with them, and we'll take them in detail. And then with this, I like to thank our participants who are logged in for last 2 hours. And with this, I'm really very grateful to Dr. Tiwari, Dr. Sthi Sharma, and we are first time meeting online with Dr. VP Singh and Dr. Singh. We are like to have more of encounters with you in the coming months, because as I understand, this pandemic is going to stay there for 2021 also. So we'll bother you again after 2 months or so with more issues. Thank you very much. And again, thank you guys for taking out your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Compliments from my side. All the 4 speakers, the slides were extremely good, not overcrowded with the content or the material, and no overlapping of the slides, overlapping of the material. So it's compliment for you that all the speakers have very good PPT presentation.
That's the just one line, because that's why we booked all those seasoned faculty members. So that's the reason, and that's everybody's benefit. Thank you again. Thank you from the core of my heart for taking out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you to all. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you and bye from Shimla. Bye-bye. And I'd like to thank my team. I forget Dr. Manmeet and for taking out, for making this event so successful. Thank you, Manmeet.